we're going to change the plan since we're working on something else and do the tribute to Marc Rowe now. So if we could have the person introducing that come up, please. Rachel. Video. Can we play that? Can we do that? Oh, can we start? Never mind. Let's get started then. I don't hear the sound. She has to hit the button. Please vote. Okay. Let's take a look at the results. Let's stop. All right, good job. Next. When I die in the name of the grace, gonna go to the place that's the best. When I lay me down to die, going up to the spirit in the sky. All right. Let's take a look at the results. Wow. Norm Greenbaum, very good. Next. Got to get all generations in. All right. See the results? All right. All right, next question.
It's just not enough.
They're both off.
So I call on people. Could you two stand up and dance for us? I like that, yeah.
Can you guess which songs were mine and which ones were Max? I was doo-wop.
Next. Oh, so see results? All right, these are too easy for you guys.
This was my wedding song.
Next. All right, no words. The results, just on the intro. All right, next. And she's watching with those eyes. They're better than you. They're better than you. Obvious. All right. Results. Woo. All right. I think we're near the end. Maybe one more. All right, results. Boom. All right. Thanks, everybody, for playing. I think we'll stop there and move on into the real session. So by being late, the good news is we had more people come in. I hope everybody has a clicker. If you don't have a clicker, please try to get a clicker. That makes it more fun. And just to remind you about this session, which we've been doing for a long time now, although today is just an hour, so not even an hour, so we won't have quite as much time. But the fun part is the discussion. And so we have microphones set up. We'll go through a question, and people should come up to the microphone and say why they do it their way or why they think it's the best way.
Or raise your hand.
I'll come
to you with the microphone.
And Todd will run around bringing the microphone to you if you don't want to get up and go to the aisle. But please participate. You were called to see a 37-week baby with this. We talked about this morning a little bit. Now what? Silo, OR primary closure, attempt bedside reduction with taped closure under sedation and intubation, attempt bedside reduction with taped closure without intubation, or something else.
Matt, what time of day is this? That's a good question.
It's always 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
That's the way my OBGYNs do this.
So raise your hand if that makes the difference for you. Time of the night. You can be honest.
All right, so primary silo wins out.
Who said something?
And that's
else?
Consistent with the data that we shared this morning about what are we doing right now in our practice, but there's been this evolution towards this taped closure.
Who said something else? It was an accident? Okay. Nobody has any comments here? Oh, come on.
David Rothstein, are you in the room? Mark Wolcan, are you in the room?
Who here has a problem with... Go ahead, Mark. Go ahead.
I got it. Could we get all the mics turned on?
I feel like it's like, come on down.
Yeah.
Price is right. Now, I picked D because I think you walk up to the NICU, and before the nurses notice that you're messing with the baby, and before they sit there and tell you that you got to do all these things, and they need 15 IVs and everything else, you can go up there, put on some clean gloves, and just see if it goes back in. And if it goes back in, you're done.
You can get it in before they finish their IVs, right?
That's my goal.
Yeah.
So do you intubate them?
No. Full disclosure, probably 9 times out of 10, the baby's already intubated when they get there. I'm not quite sure why, but they seem to be. I don't know if has everybody else experienced that? I see a lot of heads nodding.
Does anyone intubate?
But
when
not
they
for
do this.
I don't intubate to do this.
Nobody.
Well, yes. Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
If it does, so you'll try without intubation. You'll stop, wait, try again, instead of just leaving a silo.
Yeah, or you pop a silo on. Because it costs more money.
David.
Who puts a silo in everybody automatically?
Let David respond to that.
I'm going to ask a question on Lauren Berman's behalf. Who has a toolkit for gastroschisis approach, and how do you have a coordinated effort with your neonatologist, your OBGYNs, and the nurses?
What is a toolkit?
Lauren, can you take that one? No, sorry, an algorithmic approach and so that when the baby's being induced, you know what's happening.
You have a toolkit? Yeah, you've published on it.
Yeah, we do. So I would agree with the comment that try to get it in. If you get it in, you get it in. It's great. We don't intubate, but if we get there and the neonatologists have already given some morphine, well, then we're going to have to because that child's going to stop breathing.
So in this case, this is the step. So they had the primary reduction, and taped closure without intubation, and you can see your results. But what if you had bedside bowel that despite the effort you guys are just talking about to reduce, you couldn't? Then oftentimes a silo is placed at that point. So 3 days later, the bowel is reduced, and now your plan is go to the OR for closure, or now try the bedside tape closure again. Everybody got a clicker?
If anyone has a strong opinion, tell me so I can run to you.
Hey, Mac.
Yes.
Brian Gilchrist from Brooklyn.
Yeah. Blair?
I want to just point out one thing too.
Okay.
To all the speakers that have been going. When you have great centers, as you do here at Children's Hospital and Boston,
show results.
And all the talks that have been given from cervical spines and sending kids home and not worrying about them. If you're in the Bronx or if you're in Brooklyn, it's a whole different world. And a kid like this with a lot of bowel out, I'd probably just take to the operating room and primarily put it in. Sometimes you don't have the resources that some of the centers have. And I think some of these young guys who are coming up may not be in these places where you have all these accoutrements that a lot of us don't have.
And some surgeons operate outside the United States. Oh, there's Eric Hansen.
Yeah, I think that. I'll wait my turn. My oldest kid was 4 days sitting with bowel out at another hospital, got IV. That's the only one that he survived. We had zero survivor in 2011. By 2011, now our survival is about 50 to 60% in Kenya. We use out of an Asian paper, we put silos on. We reduce them rapidly, actually. Forced reduction almost, if you will, over a couple of days. And then we always save the umbilical stump. We tucked it in, we tucked it under, we didn't tape. We avoided intubation at all costs. That's what killed our kids. So even this kid, well, not that kid. That's terrible.
Sorry, I keep trying to get results to pop up, and it won't.
Yeah, so I think
if you can show the results, that'd be
great. I think that, you know, in a developing world context, having a silo that I reused, I saved them. I told all the nurses I had to keep it. I went and soaked it. I saved it again. And you can get these kids reduced. You can get the umbilical stump that I leave long, wrap it around, tegaderm over it. Even if the bowel peeks through, ignore it. Leave the tegaderm. The bowel peeks through. My partner said, I said, you can't do that. He said, yes, you can. Watch. My Kenyan partner. It works.
Fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. So this is one we need more information on. It's a 50-50 split about what's the right thing or best thing. What if the patient has this? Dissect out the matted bowel to try to make sense of damage, create a stoma, close the gastroschisis, put on a silo and watch and wait, or something else.
Any questions about the case while you're deciding? Yeah, so I knew you were going to ask. So I'll just describe it. The bowel looked necrotic. Could have been stained, but it looked pretty dead. Edit, if you could go show that again.
I think I got it.
Oh, okay. Looked dead. But it was a matted bunch of bowel, all stuck together.
All right, so looks like put on a silo and watch and wait, and create a stoma.
Okay, so the majority said D, to put on a silo. Who thinks that's nuts? Nobody? Oh, come on.
We have one.
Someone thinks it's
nuts. Well, there's a hand went up down here. Microphone's right over here. We need to know why it's nuts. Please.
So I think that, Mustafa Kabir from Chalk Children's Hospital, Orange County.
I think
first of all, my experience with dead bowel in this is somewhat limited, but of the few cases that I've had, I've been able to bring out a stoma, and that way it sort of addresses some of the problems right away. So I think that once you're there and you can see whether you can dissect it and get a stoma is probably the first thing I would try.
Do you think it's hard to pull out a stoma in the matted bunch of bowel or no?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you say it again.
Is it hard to find to pull out a stoma because it's all matted together, all the bowel?
Yeah, there's nothing easy about it. So yes, it's hard, but I think that, you know, if you have dead bowel, or at least what I can gather from that, you're going to have ongoing leakage of content, and it's going to, I think, potentially make that matting and inflammation worse.
I will say it's not always a pretty stoma.
Right.
Over here.
I'm Sharif Emile, Montreal. I'm just going to make a quick comment about the other scenario we discussed. A lot of the confusion, I think, is coming from the fact that this is very dynamic. We really don't know what the best solution is. I mean, is it better to intubate and sedate the baby and do a sutureless closure? Or is it better to fail at a sutureless closure and put a silo because you don't want to intubate and sedate the baby? We don't have answers to these. And I think time will tell which one of these is really the best.
So somebody needs to do some prospective research.
Yeah, well, I think it's happening.
Yeah, good.
But in any case, the picture you showed, it's very difficult to come up with an algorithm. Each of these patients is really unique. I think you can leave matted, obstructed bowel behind, but you can't really leave necrotic bowel behind. That patient's not going to do well. So you should resect the bowel, try to close. I would try to avoid a stoma. You can often still close, put it in a silo. You don't have to wait 6 weeks, like all the textbooks say. In a couple of weeks, you'll be able to look at that bowel. It's going to look a lot better. You'll make sense of it, and you could probably establish continuity.
What do we do?
In this case, a silo was placed. So now what? Reduce the bowel in the silo? Wait a period of time and explore? Maybe it's 7 days. Go off service and hand this over to your partner? Something else. All right, results. So wait a period of time and explore.
So what does that mean? Who answered that? Are you talking a couple days? Because the kid's got a silo right now. So how long would you wait for those of you? Because most of you said that. Who wants to be brave? And nobody. Who says 1 day? Go the next day. 2 days. 3 days. 3 days. I'm seeing about 3 days starting to happen. 4 days, 5 days, 6 days, five or six. Okay.
Football score, seven.
Sounds like four or five or six days, a lot of people would then go, leave the kid in the silo, wait 4 or 5 days, and then go back in and look.
In this case, the case was observed for 2 days and went in and did a primary closure. So seems like earlier can work, at least in this case.
Yeah. So this kid's now 6 weeks out and has an atresia, basically, is acting obstructed, and we're just going to wait a couple more weeks and take the kid back.
How about this one? Oh, comment?
Yep.
So the dead bowel miraculously underwent the Lazarus procedure.
Yeah.
Was it just meconium stained instead of dead?
No, I think it was dead. I think it just scarred. It just involuted. Yeah.
In 2 days?
No, in 4 weeks.
I don't think you can tell if it's dead.
I agree.
I think that bowel is probably still alive. Otherwise, it would have perforated, right? And I think that we can't tell, which is why I would never resuscitate.
You have an opponent. I love that. What do you think?
It's only because he trained me. No, that part that was floppy and green, I mean, that's dead.
That's not necessarily
floppy
the bowel.
Green equals
no,
dead.
It is some, if you when you dissect that out, sometimes that's just dead green, or it's just omentum. It's thrombosed omentum that's laying across the bowel. I've seen that before, where it looks like it is, and you think it's dead bowel, and it's really not. I don't think you know. I think you put a silo on and see what happens. And I've never seen one of these. I don't think I've seen one of these perforate. I'm not going to say never, because I'm sure it's happened.
Interesting.
I don't know that it's dead.
That's fine. Yeah.
Harmon Patel, Corpus Christi. So I would encourage you guys, there's one paper so far on this immunofluorescence we've been using for the last 4 years. I don't want to say a company name, but SPY, basically. And we inject these kids. So we've had similar cases. I would resect the dead bowel. We put a SPY on them. You can see exactly, no more guesswork. You see what's dead, what's not dead. And you can come back and then drop them in and come back 3 weeks later, treat them like a regular atresia. So I would encourage you guys, there's lots of tools available to check blood flow without having to guess about the bowel.
Okay, one more comment over here, and then we'll move on.
You're overlooking two basic facts. One is the meconium in these babies is the same as in meconium ileus. Your first job should be to use acetylcholine and irrigate the bowel until you've got it empty. Secondly, if you stuff it all back in, you're going to create increased abdominal pressure. You'll reduce cardiac output. You'll push up the diaphragms. All you have to do is take him to the operating room, get the bowel irrigated, stretch the abdominal wall with your fingers, and only close skin. Do it all in one step. If there's dead bowel or perforated bowel, take care of it right then and there. Don't screw around for 2 or 3 days.
You sound like a well-trained pediatric surgeon to me.
All right, the next one.
All right, what about this? You can see this is a gastroschisis with an intestinal atresia.
So I don't know if you all can see on the picture of the atresia, but there's a, can you see back there? Can everyone see it? There's an atresia, trust us. Oh, yeah.
A cord.
Okay, so how do you handle an atresia? So standard gastroschisis with an atresia. What do you do?
Here we have resect atresia, primary anastomosis, then primary reduction and closure. Resect atresia, primary anastomosis and silo, stoma and silo, stoma, reduction and closure, reduce, close, and expect secondary operation. It's kind of wordy. So the majority feel that you reduce, close, and come back a later day. Any discussion from people in the other camps?
I would go on.
In this case, primary reduction and cord closure and plan to return another day, just as the majority said. All right, new case, new topic. 16-year-old presents at 2 a.m. with mild shortness of breath and right-sided chest pain. It's the first episode. Chest x-ray shows a big right pneumothorax, spontaneous pneumothorax. Again, this morning we had a whole session on how to take care of this, so maybe everybody knows now. What next? Chest tube and ED. OR for VATS, observation and trisupplemental O2, aspiration, as we discussed this morning, and repeat chest x-ray or something else.
Is Chuck here? Chuck Lies?
Chuck? Anybody from that panel want to, Chuck? Yeah, you gave the talk. So, whoa. Chest tube and ED, OR for VATS is low, and then aspiration and repeat chest x-ray.
I am competing. I can't believe those answers. You don't believe it, right? People are getting lying. Okay. Go ahead.
So, I just presented this morning. I'm surprised it's 41%. But I think a lot of people...
You thought you had done better than that, didn't you, Chuck?
I think a lot of us are frustrated with the recurrences with this and looking for reasons to operate, but not necessarily operate on everybody because historically not everybody needs an operation. So it's a reasonable thing to try. And I think the point is if they're still leaking air when they come in, they're probably going to need an operation. So just operate on them.
I'd like to get a hand raised real quick. When we say chest tube and ED, are we thinking about the old-fashioned Argyle chest tube that's this big thing? Are we talking about the catheter, the pigtail catheter that Chuck talked about this morning already? So I think chest tube is a little it's easy to confuse what we're talking about that. Anybody else? Somebody had a hand back there. Todd's running the wrong way, sorry.
Hey, John, take the mic.
So I'll say what he's saying. What they're calling putting in a chest, what they're putting in their pigtail catheter for aspiration.
What they described as aspiration is, in my opinion, putting in a chest tube, and they decided to take it out early rather than leaving it for a period of time. I agree with their approach, but when I say aspiration, I usually mean either putting a small angiocath or something else, drawing it out, and that's a true aspiration.
And then do you take it out then?
I don't do that. That's just it. We put pigtails in, and it's much easier.
And leave it in, right.
If you have to leave it in, you leave it in. If it goes down after 6 hours and... So I don't know that what they said changes what I would do because it's already
over here.
Yeah, I'm going to add Barry Newman, Portland, Oregon. I'm going to add an E other that was only 1%, but and this is actually there is literature supporting this because we were kind of shocked when this first happened. But what we've been doing is actually putting the pigtail in, attaching it to Heimlich valve, and they send them home. They get one X-ray to make sure that the lung is re-expanded, and we just follow them as outpatients, so you save a hospital stay. You can leave it in for a little bit longer if it seems to be taking a while to come up. And eventually, by the time we get these catheters removed, most of these kids have not had recurrences, probably because we've created enough adhesions from the tube being in there for a long enough time. So we've had very few recurrences, actually. I think it's an optimal way to do it because you save a lot of money, the hospital stay, et cetera, and these kids do very well.
Thanks. Go ahead.
Right. Doug Miniotti in Roseville, California. Yeah, I would just echo that. We use the same thing, but we use a device called a Thoravent that probably everybody has heard of. Just a one-step thing. The ER guys put it in. They get sent home, you know, shortly thereafter after an X-ray confirms they're re-expanded. We see them in clinic and do a test in the clinic and take it out.
So in this case, since that was 10 p.m., patient was admitted for observation and oxygen therapy. Do we need to do this before we do anything else?
Who gets a chest CT? I don't think, does this one have a thingy?
Has what?
Does it? I don't see the numbers.
Oh, are we counting?
Here
it goes. It's a good eye. All right.
Yes.
Clear.
Anybody think that it's crazy not to get who gets chest CTs? It's okay.
10% of people in this room, Todd.
I have a lot of colleagues that get. I think
can you comment real quick? Can somebody comment? Can we get them a mic, Rachel? Thank you. We've got two down here in front who both had their hands go up.
I think it's good to know if you can already locate the bubbles, and that CT scan will be useful for later on if you need to do the...
So even if you were successful with your tube, you would know they have blebs, and next time it happened, you might, that might influence you. Daryl?
Right here. Mac? Oh, sorry.
Mac?
Yeah, I would have the patient with the pneumothorax go to the CT scanner and get a CT. And then if there's blebs that I see that are still intact, I would offer an upfront early VATS.
Okay.
And then not do any intervention until they get into the operating room.
All right, let's do this one quickly. So the next morning, the pneumothorax had not gotten better. So now we're back to the same question. I suspect the same sort of information perhaps, and we'll go on to the next step.
So Mac, while we're running through this, we have one comment over here.
Okay.
Mac, Brian Gilchrist from Brooklyn.
Hey.
The guys in Oregon who are taking care of Buffy and Jody, who are upper middle class folks, can go home with a Heimlich valve. In the Bronx, it's not happening. So I just want to point that out. And the other thing I think you've got to understand is if we have somebody with a spontaneous pneumothorax in the Bronx or in Brooklyn, and we don't do a CT scan, we never see these kids again. And so the compliance and the fact of them not coming back pushes us to do something that is in your 1% area. And we need to make sure we don't miss those. So I would impart that to you and submit that Heimlich valves aren't playing in the Bronx.
You can keep reminding us about the geography of treatment. I think that's very helpful. Very good. Very accurate. So we've got 60% going to the OR for VATS and somebody putting in about 20-30% putting in a chest tube. So in this case, they got a pigtail chest tube. Maybe that clears it up. It's not a chest tube, and it's not a catheter. It's a pigtail chest tube. And the pneumothorax resolved, and the pigtail was removed, and the patient went home. You've never seen this, I'm sure. 3 weeks later in clinic and has decreased breath sounds and chest x-ray with the pneumothorax, bigger than before. Now what? Same answers for this for the moment. This is in the clinic, so it's at 12 at noon. The counter, there we go. There we go. So this, if you go to the OR and you do the blebectomy, what about pleuridesis?
Dun, dun, dun.
You know, it was popular, then it sort of faded away, and don't want to squirt chemicals in there because it hurts.
Is Samir Pandya here? Okay, there he is. You knew I was going to call on you, man.
Let's go to the counter.
Wait till they answer.
All right. Now we have to define what that means.
All right, Ian?
Is it a Raytech scrubbing on the chest wall? Do you stick the Bovie pad in there and scrub on the chest wall?
So who uses a Bovie pad? And who does like a pleurectomy, pulls down?
Pleurectomy, yeah.
That's choice E.
Huh?
That's choice E?
It should be choice E.
Okay, fair enough.
Fair enough.
And did I miss anything else other than Bovie pad or pleurectomy? Is there like a middle ground? Mechanical and chemical. What'd you say? Using the robot?
What do the people who do no pleuridesis use?
Wait, so I want to give your comments.
Okay. How many of you that have done the pleuridesis have ever had to go back? And what do you see when you went back? Nothing. Like you were never there.
Even after a pleurectomy, that can look that way.
Right. So like nothing. So three large studies, one from Korea, two from China. Take that with whatever amount of grain of salt you want. Compared no pleuridesis to just putting fibrin sealant glue. That's it. And all they found is that the group that had pleuridesis just had more pain. But the rate of recurrence was the same.
But the study was repeated even without the fibrin glue in the China study, wasn't it?
Correct.
Yeah. And they showed the same results, no difference.
Same results, replicated, and these were hundreds of patients.
So when I heard you present that, I stopped doing pleuridesis completely.
As have I, yeah. And I haven't had an issue.
How did they consent to invite you to go back to the OR for a look-see?
Consent?
If you find blebs that you can resect, why would you need a pleuridesis?
Does anyone want to fight for? Let me. Would anyone here just now change their management to not doing pleuridesis? Wow, you guys are tough. A couple people. Okay.
Sounds like one area we don't have sorted out yet. Dave, let's put this on the list. All right. In this case, blebectomy with mechanical pleuridesis, and you did what? Bovipad.
I don't do mechanical.
You don't know. Does well post-op, and that's a real chest tube, I guess. Not very big, but it's a real one. And a patient goes home.
So, Mac, I have a quick question. Because one of my partners who gets CT scans of the chest before they go to the operating room, I asked them why. And they told me so they can look at the other side. So does anyone here, if you see a bleb on the contralateral side of those that get CT scans, how many would then do a prophylactic blebectomy?
Let's ask the second question. How many would do a prophylactic resection on the contralateral side if you saw blebs? David Powell. Who else? Say it again, Steve.
I'd discuss it with the family and the kid and let them decide. Tell them what the risk is. But it's probably easier to just take care of it to go in and resect the bleb.
Steve.
Yeah.
What do you tell the family?
I tell them that they're
what's the risk?
Tell them it's a couple percent, that they could have a spontaneous pneumo and that they might have acute symptoms. And if they live in Colorado and they're up in the mountains, that it could be a problem. Or they smoke or they're going on a foreign trip and we could take care of it and probably eliminate the risk. So
Mac, can I ask a question?
Go ahead.
So who would do a primary VATS on somebody that shows up with a spontaneous pneumothorax?
Great question. Primary VATS. Handful.
And yet somebody's going to operate on an unsymptomatic, asymptomatic bleb on the other side, but you won't operate on the side that has a spontaneous pneumothorax.
One anesthetic, Dave Powell said.
So is the anesthetic risk really the deciding reason to do that? I don't know.
We're all surgeons.
Ray,
what's the risk?
Question over behind you.
Grant Geisler from Tampa. One thing that I've discovered about doing the apical bleb resection is I think the whole apex is thinned. I think it's a diffuse disease, and when I've had recurrences, I go back and I can see a healed staple line and I have other blebs elsewhere. So I would take several staple fires across the top. And when I look at the pathology on those, I find subpleural blebs, I find apical fibrosis. So I think the whole apex is thinned. And so when I do the apical resection, I don't take a lot of lung tissue out, but I make a concerted effort to go across the top because I think the whole apex is at risk. And I think that decreases my recurrence rate better than any type of pleuridesis.
Thank you for sharing the technical aspect. We'll go on to the next case. This is a one-day-old, 2.5 kilogram male, 37-weeker, who is born with esophageal atresia and tracheoesophageal fistula. No respiratory distress, abdomen is not distended. They do have an extra thumb. Here's our chest x-ray with a tube in the upper pouch. Your very next step recommendation is for workup. Echo and all. Well, you can't do all as the very next step. In this case, workup is negative. Do you go to the OR with bronchoscopy, OR with bronchoscopy, and try to pass a Fogarty or something else? OR for thoracoscopy, OR for thoracotomy, other. I ask a question like this every 2 or 3 years to see how this is all evolving. All right. So most are going to do D, OR for in thoracotomy, and then 15% OR in thoracoscopy. All right. Any comments, discussion around this? Steve, comments? How do you do it?
So I go to the OR and I do a thoracoscopy. I do not bronch all these kids, and we can have this discussion. There are benefits to bronching them, but the truth is with a type C, the incidence of a second fistula is almost non-existent.
Well, why do I have it all the time?
So my biggest concern is anesthesia and getting them control the airway, and I think you can mess around. I don't like people like to go in and put in Fogarty's and get control and know where the fistula is, but you know, you see where the fistula is thoracoscopically quite well. So my goal is to get control of the fistula as soon as possible, and that's why we do it. If it's a pure atresia, I always bronch them because I think the incidence probably is close to 20% of an upper pouch fistula. I must admit that 20 years after doing the first thoracoscopic TEF, it's disconcerting that 15% of these cases, less than 15%.
We didn't all follow Chuck either, so, you know.
So, but, you know, that's how we do it.
Howard? Right. Please.
I was just curious how many people would be willing to accept prenatal echocardiography results before going to the OR versus requiring a postnatal echo?
Who would accept prenatal echo? Couple of hands?
It should be, yeah. I mean, the data is pretty impressive that it's don't need a second echo.
Any other comments on technique? Any of the open thoracotomy advocates want to explain why they don't like thoracoscopy or think that's not good? Someone? There are 40% of you out there. All right. Just real simple again, ask the question a different way sort of, but just focusing on these things and not bronchoscopy and the other stuff. You can have the counter. There you have it, Steve. All right, very interesting. In this case, bronchoscopy and then thoracoscopy, there was no upper pouch fistula because I seem to have them all the time, Steve. So how do you ligate the fistula? We've been arguing about this for a long time, Steve. Plastic clip, metal clip, suture ligation, or something else? Suture closure or something else? All right, plastic clip, metal clip, and then we go suture ligation, suture closure, and other. Let's see, how many of you who do thoracoscopic repair do suture closure? Where you handle it just like the open technique? There you go. One. Oh, two. All right. I'm going to go back a slide just because I've... maybe not. Steve, in the bottom right, I was wondering if we could use the ligature to ligate the fistula. Okay, no. Would you leave a transanastomotic tube? This has been up, down. The tube helps stents open. No, it causes a stricture. No, it causes leak, but you can feed early. Go ahead and the counter, yep.
So while this is running, I want to ask a question to those who do thoracotomy. If you do thoracotomy, do any of you believe that actually thoracoscopy would potentially be better, but you just don't have the skill set? Raise your hand if you're in that group that you would do. So That's impressive. So we're saying the other operation may be better, but we just don't have the skill set, which is very common in this particular operation. The question is, how are we going to move the needle on that? So how do we get centers Peter? Trained to the point where they feel very comfortable?
Peter, have a comment?
Because that's... Peter seems
I was just really interested that 68% of the people are doing thoracoscopic, because the Midwest Pediatric Surgical Group, when they looked at their group,
thoracotomy.
Oh, did I misread it? 30% only had 8% of the people. And I think I'm in a large group that we think this is a hard operation and we get one shot at it and we want to do it right. And at least for me, and I want to do what's best for the kid. I'm willing to learn, but...
But that's the question. So because everyone, a lot of people just said that potentially there is a procedure out there that we think may be better, but we just don't have the skill set. This is a problem we need to tackle because this shouldn't be the case, right? We have to figure out how to get that into every center, and I don't have the answer.
Well, I think we've got to prove that it's potentially better, but I wonder if there's a lot of people who are taking a risk. Or at least there has to be a way of training people.
All right, can we put back up the results again for the transanastomotic tube?
Well, I'll raise a question on controversy more. How many people, besides a scar, what's the advantage of thoracoscopy over thoracotomy? Obviously the scar, but what are the true advantages?
Steve? I was going to say chest wall deformity.
So there are multiple studies that show there's a higher incidence of scoliosis, shoulder girdle weakness, and chest wall deformity. And I could show you 100 pictures. So to deny that is really fantasy. There are good documented studies. Benno, where are you? You in here? Benno, you did the study, right? What's the incidence? Almost 40% in certain.
Here. We have a handy German with us today.
Benno Urano for Germany. We did this study. The incidence was about 10%, but they were all grade one because the follow-up was short.
Right.
It was below 2 years. But with time, we can expect that they are considerably higher.
Our motto is saving lives, right? Differentiating lives. And yet we're ignoring the fact that a thoracotomy has potential significant morbidity in a large percentage of these children. So that is why. It's not a scar. Although if you ask parents, and you show a parent who's had a thoracoscopic or TEF or thoracoscopic lobe, and you look at their chest and you see three little tiny quarter inch incisions, and you see someone who has a big scar, it makes a big difference to them. It makes a big difference to the kids. But it's the morbidity of the incision. And as long as we continue to ignore a relatively high potential morbidity of that incision, then it's an issue.
Real quick, I feel like I go ahead and we go back up.
Well,
two quick comments here.
I'm just going to make a quick comment about the MSK issue again. I think those studies were for classic thoracotomies where there was significant muscle division, division of the serratus anterior, very aggressive thoracotomies, most of them done a long time ago. The current thoracotomies that we do with muscle sparing are not the same type of thoracotomy. We're looking.
Emil, I'll show you the pictures.
We've published our data on esophageal atresia, looking up to 12 years out. We're now looking at patients 20 years out. Okay, adults who've had this, and we're going to publish those results soon. The MSK morbidity is minor, really minor.
Okay, real quick.
How many open cholecystectomies do you do?
The lap chole is an easy operation. The thoracoscopic.
The incidence of bile duct injury is still much higher with a low lap chole.
If I had a whistle, I'd blow it right now. You two guys, sit down.
And a mother got up and said, my surgeon was under a lot of pressure and I wish he was not.
Emil, thank you. Thank you for the comments. We got to go ahead.
I was going to move to something we have data on, and this is a transanastomotic tube.
Data? Thank you.
So with the consortium, we published data that showed that transanastomotic tubes are associated with a much higher rate of stricture formation. And then that was shown also by Marcus Malik in the Pittsburgh series retrospectively also, showing an extremely higher rate of strictures with transanastomotic tubes. There's also a recent meta-analysis that also showed increased strictures with transanastomotic tubes. So now the criticism is it's all retrospective data. But we just completed a prospective trial within the consortium, and it finished in January. We have to wait a year to follow up our patients, but we'll finally have that question answered.
Thank you very much. Kathy?
Well, I just want to say that if we're looking at advanced surgical skill, we have to swallow our pride and say that it's okay to say we don't have those skills, but then to seek out opportunities to gain those skills. Simulation-based education, you all know that I'm big into simulation, I'm big into skills acquisition, but it works. It takes high-risk, rare operations, and it puts them in the lab where we gain our skills, and that's appropriate. The data show that we, as a group, do one TEF a year on average. One. And whether you do it thoracoscopically or whether you do it open, one a year is not enough to maintain your skill set. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you trained. One is not sufficient. So we need to be able to swallow our pride and say that there are opportunities for us to gain those skills, to maintain those skills once we gain them in fellowship or begin to gain them in fellowship, and to seek those opportunities where they exist, because they do exist. There are great opportunities to do so. Now, I will say I am biased because I do own a patent on models, so take me with a grain of salt because I do admit that I have a disclosure.
Thank you for that conflict of interest statement at the end. Thank you.
Is that on? Andreas Meyer, SUNY Upstate. I want to thank Dr. Lal and his group. We put anastomotic tubes in on everyone. We don't do that anymore, and I think the data are clear that you shouldn't.
All right, we got 5 minutes, so let's try to keep going. In this case, bronchoscopy and thoracoscopic ligation with anastomosis, the gap was 2 centimeters and a 5-French feeding tube was passed and a chest tube was placed. Started on feeds through the NG. Would you, on post-op day one, would you feed through the MG if you put it in by mistake? Keep NPO or try for transduodenal tube feeding? Let's go quickly if we can. Start feeds, keep NPO, okay. Post-op esophagram, none, 3, 5, 7, somewhere in that range after that. Post-op day 7, all right. Post-op day 5, and anybody in the 8% none, quickly stand up and make a comment, since, please.
So one of my partners, Hal Lay, did a little study on this. It's unpublished right now, but he looked at all the esophagrams we had done, and the ones with leaks, they all had clinical signs. So the bottom line is you don't need the esophagram if you're looking for leak.
So in other words, you get sick if you have a problem. You don't need to see it on the esophagram.
Yes, I would like to make a similar comments. I don't do a contrast study following esophageal tracheal repair, both thoracoscopic or open. And I've been doing this for many years. And actually, the results of the series from Great Ormond Street Hospital, where I was working before, is supporting this concept. We didn't have a major clinical leak by doing that. Obviously, we could not see the non-clinical leaks, but in terms of stricture rate or other things, the results were supporting the fact of not doing a contrast study.
Thank you very much. Mike, one quick comment? Oh, I'm sorry. Over here. Sorry, I didn't see.
Thanks. Without a contrast study, when would you start feeds?
Chuck? Piero, when would you start feeds?
Oh, wait, Augustine. I start giving feeds on post-operative day 2. And I could also go orally if there is no tension on the anastomosis. There is a lot of saliva that goes through the esophagus independently of the feeds.
Thanks.
Yeah, I totally agree. This is the way to do it, is avoid esophagram, because what you'll see, if it's a big leak, you're going to know, right? If it's something contained leak, you can feed through that. There's no problem with that. So this could avoid a lot of radiation.
There's a big difference between 92% and 8%. Tom?
Yeah, so at the risk of having my crazy moment like Crummell did this morning, I just want to bring up
So Marjaka pointed out the concern for advanced failure that's going up and up and up. And as I'm listening to this, I'm so grateful that you've done this, because one of the things that I think the board members who are here, all board members who've been through the board, can see how much variability without any correct answers. And to hear that great data is evolving, and yet we thought that when we did the last iteration of the boards, we were putting together subject matter experts and delivering an exam by subject matter experts. And that's one of the things that we need to realize, is that when we come out of training, there's a lot of difference that's across that may not be measured in failure or certification. So sessions like this are really important to elicit the variation that goes on, not only in our practices, but in our training.
Thank you, Todd.
Thank you.
Bassem Khalil from Sidra Medicine in Qatar. I actually come from the United Kingdom. And 20 years ago, Britain decided that, exactly as one of the speakers said, if you do one case of esophageal atresia a year, that's not enough, no matter where you trained and no matter who you are. So the UK decided that at consultant level, we will have to subspecialize into upper GI and lower GI, so that you have one group of surgeons in any center doing the esophageal atresias, so that they don't dilute the cases. The results from the UK found out that the results in these situations are much better. I'm just asking, why is the United States still not subspecializing?
Who's going to answer that?
I'll answer that. So we looked at volume and outcomes in the consortium. And in the Midwest consortium, volume of data per surgeon did not have any correlation with complication rates.
Great. Mac, should we stop?
Yep. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody,
for your participation. Rachel, are you up?
Wait, we have a tribute.
We have the tribute to go, right. So everybody sit tight.
Dr. Rowe was born in Massachusetts during the Depression. He struggled with dyslexia, and he was presumed to not be smart enough for college. Thus, he was planning on becoming a welder. This all changed when the wrestling coach at Brown saw him compete in the championships and offered him an athletic scholarship. Then, with dedication and a lot of hard work, he went to Tufts for medical school.
I found this book called The Surgery of Infants in Childhood by Robert E. Gross. Mm-hmm. Thing from cover to cover. And I used to watch Dr. Gross operate. He just was the most incredible, insightful technician. You could see his mind and his body working together. And I used to stand there in the operating room watching him holding a hemostat in my hand, and when nobody was looking, try to mimic how he did it. That was really when I said, there ain't no way that I'm not going to become a pediatric surgeon.
He went to Boston City Hospital for his general surgery residency, and after his intern year, he dedicated time during the Korean War to serve as a surgeon and captain in the U.S. Army Medical Corps. And in 1966, he completed his pediatric surgery residency at Columbus Children's Hospital under the direction of Dr. Clatworthy. Over the rest of his career, he was an academic pediatric surgeon at the University of Chicago, where he focused on his NIH-funded study of hemorrhagic shock in neonates. The University of Miami, where he obtained the John A. Hartford Foundation Award to study neonatal circulation, and then moved to Pittsburgh, where he continued his investigations, including bacterial translocation in the gut. He refereed 186 journal articles, 98 book chapters, and edited 5 books. He received 2 NIH grants and 1 John A. Hartford Foundation Award. He worked with other leaders to shape the future of pediatric surgery by acting as the chairman of the surgical section of the AAP, becoming a founding member of APSA, leading as president of APSA in 1999, creating board certification for pediatric surgery and directing the American Board of Surgery, standardizing curriculum and index cases through the Residency Review Committee, educating as the pediatric surgery program director at the University of Pittsburgh, and shaping our knowledge as an associate editor of JPS. His unique approach to life and problem solving have been passed on to many, with 14 pediatric surgery children, 46 grandchildren, and 8 great-grandchildren.
You got to know when to hold, know when to fold up.
He just taught you how to think and ask the right questions, and that served me very well in all of my career.
It's the failure to pay attention to detail that kills kids. 8 hours in the life of a newborn baby is like 24 plus hours in the life of an adult.
He gave me a gift. And what Dr. Rowe said was, Maury, what you need to learn is how not to hang up the monkey, but how to take the monkey off your back and pass it to the next guy. Learn to pass the monkey.
And he said, no, he said, you got the little men. Those are the things in the back of your mind that tells you what to do.
You know, he's a family man, loves his kids. He was very, very kind.
After retiring to Sanibel Island, Florida, he has filled his time working with the Coast Guard, mastering Tai Chi, wood carving, and so much more.
You know, if you really think about why you're a doctor or why you're particularly a pediatric surgeon, to me it's very simple. It's to fix up little kids.